Greetings, this is part 7 of my series on the history of Halloween Horror Nights 20 Years of Fear. And I've now quite happily remembered what I forgot to say in one of the previous videos, right about the time when I was talking about how fear was revealed, or rather how fear was not revealed on the website, or on the billboards, or on the brochures, or in the television commercial. You really didn't get to see what fear was really like yet until you actually encountered him in the park at the event. And this prompted some people, most notably my friend Chris, who uses the fake last name Redfield as if he was a Resident Evil character — that's not actually his name — and has since moved to California, and unlike Rob, is not coming back. But we'll stay there. He's got actually has gainful employment now. Who would have thought? And apparently working in some capacity at Universal Studios Hollywood, although I think he's working at the Hard Rock or something over there. But anyway, what I failed to mention is that Chris began to make a lot of jokes about the fact we didn't really know what fear was like yet, because, of course, he was a great fan of Buffy the Vampire Slayer. And there's one classic episode of that program called Fear Itself. And we couldn't help but think about the fear demon, Grachnar, that is going to come. And everyone was all worked out and frightened by this approaching doom of this dreadful fear demon. It was a Halloween episode. Those were always fun on Buffy. And not only was it a Halloween episode, it was also the episode in which we learned for the first time that Anya was scared of bunnies. Smart girl, bunnies are frightening. It's dangerous, demented, long-haired varmints! Yes, I learned from all those Warner Brother cartoons just how dangerous a bunny can be. Oh dear. Be very, very quiet. Yes, indeed. But enough of those strange lapses on my part. Let's get back to the episode in question, where, indeed, Grachnar, the fear demon, and Chris kept posting, "From below it devours!" as a reference to that, at that time, back when fear was going to be revealed, allegedly. And, of course, when Grachnar did materialize, they found out that really scary image in the ancient tome had fine print that said actual size. It was about yay big, and so you had this little dinky thing on the ground. "I am Grachnar, the demon of fear." And Xander's like, "Who's your little fear demon? Who's your good boy? Who's your little fear demon?" And then Giles has to be like, "Please don't taunt the fear demon. Why? Could he hurt me?" "No, it's just tacky." Yes, love that. Love that bit. So, yes, that's what we're making fear demon jokes because of that. And the other bit, of course, that I wanted to point out was about, not a joke, but the fact that the lantern itself, we began to notice that sometimes when it flamed up on the website, you could make out in the fire itself the faces of the icons of Jack and the caretaker, the usher, the storyteller, and the director. That was kind of cool. And later on we'd find out that in the filigree, the metal design, not only was there the big double X, but in the metal design and the filigree of the outside of the lantern, you could find things like a pair of glasses for the storyteller, or a flashlight for the usher, or a little camera for the director, and things like that. The stopwatch of the caretaker. I forget what Jack had. It might have just been his big happy face. I don't know, something for Jack. But it was on there, and it was just kind of amusing that they worked all this detail in to see if anyone would notice. That was nifty. And the other little bit I failed to mention in the previous videos are the actual dates of the event. So the event was held for 24 nights, beginning on the final Friday of the month of September which was usual on that day, but I think that time was the last time that ever happened. I think from 21 on, it was on an earlier Friday in the year, not the final Friday, but the second to last Friday. And now it looks like it's going to be, you know, two Fridays back. Oh my God, next thing you know, it'll be the first Friday. Not yet, but the way things are going. But it was September 24th, which was probably the earliest date it could be and still be on the last Friday of the month. If you do the math, you'll see I'm right, because that would make the 30th. That would make the 30th then a Thursday, you see. That's the only way you could do it. So, but it was September 24th, 25th, and 30th. And then it was October 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th, 20th, 21st, 22nd, 23rd, 24th, 27th, 28th, 29th, 30th, and the 31st. Halloween night was the last night of the event. 24 nights of Halloween Horror Nights. 20 years of fear. So, got that out of the way. And so, after that, I can pick up now where I left off in part 6. And that was discussing. I had just finished with the Hallowed Past. Finished the first 4 houses. That's half the houses, because they only had 8 houses. So the other 8 houses, all original houses, of course. Then the 5th house, that was the house that was originally meant to be the icon house that year. Because originally they planned for little Cindy to be the icon of the event. Well, as you know, as already mentioned, they couldn't do Cindy. What is this noise? Who's... Oh, every time certain people tweet, it comes up on my phone. It's with the noise. Okay, getting back to it then. They had originally intended for it to be the icon, and that would be the iconic house. Correct. But then what happened was she could not be the icon anymore. The decision was made. They had to come up with a whole new icon from scratch. Grachnar! I'm a fear demon! No, they're not that one. The demon Adaru, fear. Fear himself, fear itself. And so that had to be the new icon. They had to come up with that quickly, and they did. But they didn't change any of the houses. The houses all stayed the same. Therefore, Cindy's house stayed the same house it was always all along. So no longer an icon house, but a house for Cindy. So Cindy finally got her own house, but she didn't get to be icon. It also meant something else. For the first time since they started having icons, now there'd be an icon without a house. It wouldn't be the last time that happened, but it was the first time it happened. Because, of course, every other time they had an icon, whether it was the Crypt Keeper, if he counts, but he had a house both times he was there, including the time he was an icon. Both 95 and 96, and Jack, and the caretaker, and the director, and the storyteller, and the usher, whenever they were icons, either individually or together, they had their own house. But then, and sometimes, you know, if they had 4 of them, 4, you know, they each had their own houses. So that was rather nifty. But now, now, the icon of the event, Fear, was homeless. Oh, poor little Fear Demon. Don't want the Fear Demon, that's tacky. Yes, yes, poor guy, he didn't have a house. He had to stay on the street all night. But Cindy did. Yes. Alright, so, now, to refresh your memories, in case you weren't familiar, Cindy, of course, was meant to be the icon in 2002, and the back story was that she was the daughter of, originally, Paul Bearer, a creepy little mortician who lived with his family somewhere. And I don't know if they actually did anything nefarious, but they were considered creepy and kooky, mysterious and ooky, and therefore the local townspeople looked at them with suspicion and distrust. The prejudiced bastards. And so one day they burned the Bearer house to the ground. By the way, Paul Bearer is, of course, an homage to a horror host, television horror host, who was right here in Central Florida for many years. But they burned it down, and it, of course, killed the entire family except for the little girl, Cindy. although she was grotesquely disfigured, as she covered her scars with a porcelain doll's mask. A little baby doll mask, just a little crack on one side. And then somehow she apparently had some sort of supernatural powers, and from her toy box all sorts of marvelous toys came to life to become all the characters that were in the event of Halloween Horror Nights 12, Islands of Fear. Except, of course, because too many actual little girls were being killed in rather nasty ways in the public eye, in the news, all sorts of big stories that were all over the news and everybody was concerned about it. Somebody decided to be a public relations nightmare to have a creepy little dead girl as the icon for the event. And so they axed Cindy and replaced her with a reworked version of her father, now Albert Caine, the caretaker. Snip, snip, your time has come, yes. So that happened, of course, as is well known to most, or some, or whoever, or should be. If you watch my previous videos, you'd know that already. And of course, there was no sign of Cindy at all in the house, except there were some pictures of some little girls in the original Scream House that some people who knew about the story, although it wasn't widely publicized, those who might know the story thought, well, gee, Albert Caine, that must be his daughter Cindy, who didn't get used this year. A little blonde girl in the picture, although she looked nothing like the dark-haired lass that was eventually revealed in when they gave some of this. Well, in fact, actually, if you'd looked in a newspaper at a certain time of the year, you might have seen the little dark-haired girl before, during audition advertisements, before they changed it up to the caretaker. And you know, I learned about this from some of my spies. A certain actor who has worked at Universal, not the one you're thinking of, a different one altogether. Let's just say, he used to come as a guest over to Pleasure Island once in a while, and used to fill me in, and he's the one who told me that in the islands, Cindy got replaced with Albert, who was sort of, maybe not quite, her father. Well, what happened with that, of course, we wondered about that, but I guess they decided that was a good thing, and that was sort of what the backstory we were thinking. And in 2006, it was all verified, because when they retconned the whole idea of the caretaker and gave him that nice Victorian mansion to live in with all those minions running around, his followers, we found out that all of his dismembering and experiments was to try to locate the human soul so that he could resurrect his beloved Cindy from the dead. And there she was, lying serenely in her coffin like Snow White, waiting for Prince Charming to come give her a kiss. Yes. So we saw her in there, the dead Cindy, in that house. And then, of course, we learned that he must have succeeded somehow, because in 2009, there she was, alive and kicking in return to have fun in the shadows of the past scare zone, the final night of that event. So, now Cindy's back, and now she's going to have a house. That's what we were expecting. But then we found out there was more to the story of Cindy Caine than we had realized. As it turns out, Cindy Caine was not Albert Caine's biological daughter at all. No. She wasn't even from Georgia. I think Albert Caine, according to the website in 2002, he lived somewhere like Shady Oaks or something like that, Georgia. In fact, Cindy grew up in Cary, Ohio. That place again. Yes, scary Cary, wherever by all sorts of weird stuff goes down. Yes. Apparently, and whoever her real parents were they Paul Bearer? I don't know if that story was still used, but somehow they died mysteriously. My guess would be in a fire, but in this case, I now no longer suspect the townsfolk. I sort of suspect little Cindy herself, but at any rate, she got taken in to an orphanage, the Good Harvest Orphanage, I believe. That's the full name of that, is the Good Harvest Home for Orphans, yes. a good harvest home for Orfanage in Cary, Ohio. And she was taken in there, and apparently, based on some of the things we actually saw in the house, those people who ran that orphanage were not necessarily the nicest little people in the world. They were a bit Miss Hannigan-like in their harshness, and I don't think some of those little orphans that were in that orphanage regretted being placed in the care of such harsh masters. Cindy certainly would have bridled at such treatment, I am certain. But I think the other little orphans were a little bit, shall we say, they looked upon Cindy with a certain sense of awe. Not aww, but awe. Oh, they might have been worried about, you know, pissing her off. That's a little bit scared of Cindy. She's a little bit too eerie and not someone to be messed with. They were smart. If there were any bullies amongst those orphans, they would have quickly learned that Cindy was not one to pick on. Nothing like getting your ass burned off to teach you a lesson, I think. But basically, in a weird way, I think Cindy felt sorry for the other orphans and sort of became that Annie, if you were, but in a very twisted way. Because one night on Halloween, when the orphan masters at least indulged the children a little bit and let them wear some masks and costumes, probably to get them out of their hair, while they went off and drank booze and had sex or something. That's what those creepy, nasty, corrupt adults always do. Yes, the little children were playing, and Cindy realized it was time to liberate her fellow orphans, liberate them from this tyranny, liberate them from the tyranny of the orphanage, liberate them from the tyranny of life itself. Yes, and then we found out that there's something about Cindy we never suspected. She wasn't just a creepy little living dead girl, whatever she was, but she was in the genre of horror of the weird little kid with supernatural powers. Yes, just like little Danny Torrance or little Damien Thorne or some other little kid whose eyes will suddenly get narrow and things move by themselves or something scary is about to happen. Yes. And Stephen King is an issue here. Yes, absolutely. She sort of resembled, not physically, but in her nature, a little girl, I think, named Charlie McGee, who was played by Drew Barrymore in Firestarter. Yes, she was a little incendiary Cindy, wasn't she? She had that ability, that preternatural ability to burn things with her mind. Pyrokinesis. And so all the bad people who were mean to Cindy and the other orphans, though, it was like crackle, 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 crispy, 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 ashes, ashes, burned away. Yes, but of course the fire consumed the orphanage and all the orphans as well. But now, thanks to Cindy's manipulations, the adults are gone, perhaps burning in hell where they belong, but Cindy and the orphans can live forever as undead revenants returned from the ashes as partying trick-or-treaters of the darkness. Like the school children from 2008. They sort of resembled them since they're all in their Halloween masks and costumes, with Cindy as their leader. It's just getting a little bit too cold now as the sun is going down. I don't need that thing going anymore. I'm getting a bit of a chill. Now I can hear better anyway. Oh, yes. So that's the scenario when you enter the house. The orphanage, ashes to ashes. Orphanage spelled with an F instead of a PH, as if by the hand of a child, which also connected it to the school and the schoolhouse, where, of course, the scrawled hand that we have a K instead of a CH, spelled phonetically, as if by an uneducated child or perhaps a lolcat. Anyway, you go into the house, and it was set, of course, in the Joel's extended queue area, one of not the last house there, but the second to the last house there. One of the few houses, the last few houses in that area, which no longer exists, indeed. Yes, it's all part of Diagon Alley now. But the house, you go in, and there's a sign, of course, Good Harvest Home. You enter in and you smell. You can smell the burning. You can smell the smoke and the barbecue-like smell, perhaps even of burning flesh as well as burning wood. And you see embers and glowing, and there are orphans all around you, and Cindy herself gleefully laughing, but also, and playful, and also little orphan children with their mass, and they would pop out and slash at you with knives and things while giggling delightfully. Yes, as children like to have fun, which includes killing adults. And you also saw the evidence I was mentioning, that they were not treated very well in an orphanage. The beds with restraints on them, the cages that they used, you know, the sort of thing that animals would normally be kept in. So yeah, you can tell that those weren't the nicest orphan keepers. So they deserved what they got. And as you go through it, you have all sorts of interesting scenes where the orphans would jump out, and all dressed in their funny costumes for Halloween, including pirates and princesses and clowns and what have you. There was even a pirate climbing and rigging, like ship rigging that they had set up in one area. That was kind of fun. There was a very famous effect that was hyped beyond all belief of actual burning fire in the house. And of course these flames, I'll get to that next time. I've hit the 20-minute mark.